first part of this session, I would like just to finish off the discussion which I was giving actually in the first lecture of this series, concerned with the quantum measurement problem, macrorealism and weak measurement. Now, since I did in fact go through the motivation of this whole business in the first lecture, I won't try to repeat that. Now, let's just assume that we are interested in the possibility that quantum mechanics might not be the whole truth about the, you know, the world, and that's at some kind of level between the level of the atom and that of cats and everyday objects, something else might come in. Okay, let's take that for granted and see what, if anything, we can say about that. So here are the hypothesis A, which I haven't presented explicitly here, is obviously that quantum mechanics is the whole truth about the world up to essentially an arbitrarily macroscopic level. And hypothesis B is that that's not right. At the macroscopic level, or perhaps somewhere between the atomic and the macroscopic level, some other non-quantum mechanical principles enter. In such a way that quantum superpositions of macroscopically distinct states, like the superpositions of the living and dead states of Schrödinger's cat, say, don't in fact exist in real life. Now there are, as I think I mentioned briefly in the earlier lecture, there are specific scenarios in which this might happen, and the best developed of those is the GRWP, Girardi-Rimini-Weber-Pearl scenario. But I'm not going to stick my flag definitively on that. I'm just going to consider the general class of hypotheses which I'll call macrorealistic. That is, they are so engineered, they are scenarios which are so engineered as to ensure that a macroscopic object does always land up in a definite macroscopic state. Each particular Schrödinger's cat ends up either alive or dead and not in some kind of weird quantum superposition. Okay, so these are the possible hypotheses, or at least the most obvious ones, the question is how might we tell? At this point, let me make a slight digression and mention a, this is, it's, in some sense, I'm doing this because this is cannibalized for another talk, but it's an interesting topic in its own right. Okay, so let me just very very crude briefly mention this connection with EPR-Bell. I assume that all of you are familiar with the usual analysis of the EPR-Bell setup, but I would like to just comment on one point, which is, I think, somewhat important in this context. You've all heard of the various loopholes in the alleged refutation of local realism by experiment. I mean, there are things like the freedom of choice loophole. Did you really choose your what to measure in a completely arbitrary way? There's the so-called detector efficiency loophole, etc., etc. But one there's a particular kind of loophole. I don't even know if you want to call it a loophole, which is a bit different in this respect, and that's sometimes called the collapse locality loophole. It's been pointed out by many people ever since the original Friedman-Clauser aspect experiments, that the analysis, the standard analysis of what's going on in the Bell's theorem experiment, does rely heavily, implicitly, on the idea that a definite outcome is realized at some reasonably early stage in the whole process. Now, the most obvious point at which you might say a definite you might think at first sight a definite outcome is realized is when you present a given photon with a polarizer and the photon has to decide whether to pass it or not. But you know that that really is not likely to be right, because after all, in other kinds of experiments using Mach-Zehnder interferometry and so forth, you can actually exhibit interference between the transmitted and reflected states. So the photon in some sense doesn't seem really to make a choice at that point. Okay, so the next possibility is that the photon now say enters or does not enter the cathode. Is it cathode or the anode? I always forget which way around it is. The appropriate bit of your photon multiplier, and thereby starts to trigger some kind of electronic cascade process. And a lot of people say, oh, well, that's obviously where a definite outcome is realized. And then they use the usual bogus decoherence argument to say that since you can't anymore exhibit interference between the triggered and untriggered states of your photomultiplier, something definite must have happened there, which to my mind is a complete non sequitur. So if you take this argument seriously and carry it on, eventually, of course, you get to the stage where no outcome is realized until you've actually correlated the output of your two photomultipliers in your distant alpine villages, or whatever they are, back in the central post office in downtown Geneva, and actually seen that you've got a coincidence or not. And in that case, of course, by that time, of course, there's no question of non-local correlations. Well, this is just, of course, this whole argument is just a special case of the sort of more generic Schrodinger's cat type of argument. You simply don't, there's no criterion given within the formalism of quantum mechanics for when you should actually say a definite outcome is realized. So that's just another, in some sense, another incentive to try to ask, can we say something about this question directly from experiments? That is, can we test the validity of quantum mechanics with the usual ideas of superposition and interference and so forth at some reasonably macroscopic level? Okay, so that's what I want to discuss, and to some extent I'm repeating some of what I said in lecture one here. I did discuss in lecture one the question of what we mean by macroscopically distinct states and what kinds of criteria and what kinds of figure of merit we could use for those, so I won't repeat that here. But imagine that we have some reasonably macroscopic system, it might be perhaps some kind of Josephson device, which has available to it two states which we've agreed are reasonably called macroscopically distinct. So that's another issue, we could go back to that if anyone wants to. Then, crudely speaking, you can think of a primitive test which goes at something like the following. Suppose that we know that starting from the plus one state, I'll always denote the relevant variable which tells you which macroscopic state you have by Q, capital Q, and the eigenvalues of Q will be plus one and minus one. So for example, these might be the clockwise and counterclockwise circulating states of a squid. So imagine that we've done a series of experiments in which we started our system from Q equals plus one, and we've then observed what's happened to it at some intermediate time. And we find that it's basically may have gone either to the plus state or the minus state, let's say with approximately equal probabilities. And that's an experimental fact. Okay? Again, we started off from the minus one state and find that again it's gone to either one of these with approximately equal probability. So now, let's imagine that we do the following. We started off from the plus state and ask, what is the appropriate description of the state at some intermediate time? Well, we already know that if we started off in the plus state, then we had some probability of going to plus and some to minus at a final time, ditto if we started off in the minus state. So if in fact the state at this time is either plus or minus, then it seems that inevitably at the final time there is some probability for getting plus and some for getting minus. Okay? However, of course, as you know, quantum mechanics takes a different point of view. It says that at this intermediate time, the state is not a classical mixture, but a quantum superposition of these two states. Then we have to calculate the amplitude going on from here to there, from here to there. We may find, if we've set the experiment up correctly, that there is complete destructive interference between these possibilities. And therefore, quantum mechanics would predict that the state at the final time is most definitely minus, with no probability of getting plus at all. And therefore, at first sight, we might try to do an experiment along these lines, and if we indeed verify that this is what we get, that we definitely get the minus state and never the plus state at the final time, then this will be prima facie evidence that at the intermediate time we had a quantum superposition and not a mixture. Well, so far so good, but there are all sorts of rather obvious possible holes in this argument. For example, we're implicitly assuming that what the system does beyond this point is independent of its history before this point. So, you know, it just isn't a terribly clean kind of argument. So let's try to make it a little tighter. Okay, so what we'd like to do is to take this rather hand-waving argument and see if we can make it a bit more quantitative. And one way of doing so is to try to derive what you might call a Bell or CHSH inequality in time. Well, let me just write it down. I'll come back in a moment to what conditions we need to assume to derive it. So the formal structure of our CHSH inequality is this. Like the original CHSH inequality, it relates four experimentally measured expectation values, or correlations. The difference now is that in the original version, of course, you're talking about the correlation of two spatially separated photons as a function of the angle of polarization. In this case, it's although the formal structure is the same, the meaning of the symbols is different. You're talking about the observations of the quantity Q, which remember is a dichotomic variable, at different times. So you notice, so we're talking here about ensemble averages, and what is essential to bear in mind is that you're doing repeated runs here. To get this correlation function here, you start off your ensemble in what is hopefully a known state, and you measure Q only at times T1 and T2. Similarly here, let's say, you would measure only at times T1 and T4, no intermediate measurements, or no measurements at other times. Now, in fact, in distinction from the original CHSH inequality, where it's a non-trivial assumption that you can, as it were, a priori, take some of these times to be the same, in this case, it's rather trivial to observe that without loss, you can actually take T3 to be equal to T4. And you then get this rather simplified version of the inequality. And those who like to minimize the significance of this argument like to point out that this was actually derived by Boole in 1862. But of course, Boole didn't know about quantum mechanics, so he couldn't make the applications that we're going to do. Well, what are the quantum predictions? The quantum predictions for an ideal two-state system with a tunneling amplitude of omega zero are that independently, and this is an interesting feature of the quantum mechanics of a simple idealized two-state system, doesn't matter what state you start with, the two-time correlations with no intermediate measurements made are always given by this simple formula here. Okay. So let's take a special case of that. If we take the intervals to be given by Tor here, then you find that K, which is now a function only of Tor, is twice cos omega t minus cos twice omega t. And that actually turns out to violate this inequality for some values of Tor, and maximally at Tor is pi over 3 omega 0, where k is actually 1.5, hence not less than or equal to 1. So the general structure of the argument is almost identical to that of the original Bell CHSH argument. Now, what ingredients? The interesting question is, what ingredients do we need to prove the CHSH-like inequality in time? Now, it turns out one ingredient which is certainly necessary in some sense or other is induction. That is, we do need, just as in the original CHSH, Bell CHSH arguments, we need to assume, in some cases people tend to do this implicitly, that the state of a physical ensemble is determined by initial conditions and not by final conditions. In other words, that crudely speaking, the past causes the present causes the future, not vice versa. Now, interestingly, and in distinction from the original CHSH arguments, it is possible to turn this argument around. The argument still turns out to work if you assume that the ensemble is determined only by final conditions, but you can't have a mixture of the two. Okay? That's a technical issue which I think is not of particular interest in this context, so I won't say any more about that. But let's just assume, for the sake of argument, that we assume we're going to assume induction in the usual sense. So in other words, it's the ensemble is defined by the initial conditions with which we started it. Second condition, this is really the crunch point, as it were, we do need the assumption of macrorealism. That is, we need to make the assumption that at all times, either Q equals plus one or Q equals minus one. But now, wait a moment, if you come to think about it, what are we actually saying when we say that? Okay? We've got these symbols here, but what does it mean to say that at all times, even when I wasn't observing it, Q is either plus one or minus one? Well, of course, this tends to bring to mind the famous statement made in a rather different, famous question raised in a rather different context. It all depends what the meaning of is. And so what does it mean to say that Q is plus one or minus one? Again, I think that, of course, the same question arises at the microscopic level. In that case, we were able, in the first lecture, to, in some sense, redefine the question by saying, okay, what we mean by saying that a particular photon, which is not observed, has, let's say, polarization in a particular direction, is that if we had chosen to set up a macroscopic apparatus to observe it, then that apparatus would have clicked. So that's what we actually mean by that. So we're defining a statement which is at least prima facie, grammatically, about the real existence situation in terms of a counterfactual, what would have happened had we done something which we hadn't done. And I think at the last resort, you have to conclude that's the only choice possible also at the macroscopic level. In other words, when we say that Q, we believe that Q is actually equal to plus one at some particular time, the only thing we can really mean is that had we actually measured it, we would have got the value plus one. Now, some people, and particularly some philosophers, really don't like the whole idea of counterfactual statements. And if indeed you don't like it, well, then I'm afraid you probably have to conclude that the whole idea of macrorealism is really ill-defined and so forth, which is a possible conclusion, one we might perhaps want to draw. But at least it's worth, I think, raising the issue. We are defined, so I think I do, on the whole, rather like the idea of counterfactual definiteness. It is a sort of, as I mentioned, I think previously, it's a sort of idea which you commonly use in everyday life and in the legal system and so on and so forth. So I'm a little hesitant to give it up. In some sense, we're using the same maneuver then as we did in interpreting statements at the microscopic level. However, there is an important difference here. We now are able to, as it were, postpone the choice of whether we're going to measure the quantity or not, right up to the macroscopic or everyday level, whereas previously we had to do it at the microscopic. Okay, now, the interesting point, and this is a point which really I think has no obvious analogue in the, it has an analogue but it's not really terribly close in the original CHSH context, is that if you merely make these two assumptions, then you really can't prove anything much, because the measurement at the first time, at the first time of the pair, that is the measurement say at T1, could have affected the ensemble. And in fact, we might think that it's rather natural that it would affect the ensemble. A sub-ensemble in which I've measured Q at time T1 and got a particular value might well not have the same statistical properties as an ensemble which I haven't done that. Now, in the original EPR Bell context, we get around that by the corresponding statement would be that by measuring some particular value of polarization out here, I might have affected the properties of the ensemble of photons out here. And I get around that by invoking the principle of special relativity. But here I have no concept of space-like separation, so I can't do that. So I have to find some substitute for that. So what we have to add is a concept which I call non-invasive measurability. crudely speaking, in principle, it should be possible to measure the quantity Q of t without affecting the state of the ensemble or its subsequent behavior. Now, notice carefully, this is not a quantum mechanical principle. However, it does seem a very plausible principle, at least in the context of macrorealism. And let's try to make it plausible by introducing the idea of an ideal negative result experiment. Suppose that we manage to hook up the system to a measuring device in such a way that we believe that if the system is in the plus state, then it will interact physically with the measuring device, and the measuring device may click. If it's in the minus state, then there is no physical interaction with the measuring device. The most obvious example of this might be, for example, say that I have this stapler. The stapler can be either this side of the cup or this side. Suppose I shine my flashlight on this side of the cup only. Then, by all our usual conceptions about the laws of physics, if the stapler was indeed here, then no doubt there will be interaction between the beam of the flashlight and the stapler. And I'm going to throw that run away because I might have interfered with the stapler. On the other hand, if the stapler, quote, really was, unquote, on this side, then there should have been no physical interaction here. Okay? And I'm going to keep that run with some confidence that I could not have affected, that within a macrorealistic theory, I could not have affected the state or its properties. Now, as I say, it is an assumption. The question is, can I, in some sense, justify make it more plausible, the idea that within a macrorealistic theory, if the system was indeed in this state, then the measuring device could not have affected it. In other words, what I'm going to call this assumption the assumption of classical non-invasive non-invasiveness. Okay. So how am I going to test that? Well, there's a sense in which I can test it. This is something I proposed very briefly, probably in retrospect, much too briefly, in a paper way back in 1988, I think. Very recently, there's been a long paper by Wild and Meisel who've gone into this in extreme detail, and they've done a probably complete job on it. This is in Foundations of Physics, I think, in February of this year. So what you do is the following ancillary experiment. You prepare your system in a given state at time ti, initial time. You choose an intermediate time so that quantum mechanics unambiguously predicts that the value of Q at that intermediate time is, let us say, minus 1. Next, we verify experimentally that under these conditions, Q at the intermediate time is minus 1. In other words, that our measuring device, which is coupled only to the plus state, does not click. Next, we measure Q at some final time in a series of runs in which we simply made no measurement at the intermediate time. Then again, we do a different set of runs in which we again measure Q at the final time, but in this case, we did actually make what we hoped would be an ideal negative result measurement at the intermediate time. Finally, we compare the statistics on runs 3 and 4, and if they agree, then at least that's consistent with the hypothesis of classical non-invasiveness, if you like, non-invasive measurability. Okay, does everyone follow how that works? We're basically we're deliberately taking a case in which we know that at some intermediate time, because we tested on previous runs, we know that the system is definitely in the minus state. We believe that our measurement apparatus only affects it physically if it's in the plus state. And this is a test to see if that's right or not. Okay, so very briefly, let's just do the proof of the CHSH-like inequality in time from these three assumptions. Remember, that's induction, macrorealism, and non-invasive measurability. From the assumption of macrorealism, either Q is plus 1 or Q is minus 1 at all times, irrespective of whether or not we're choosing to measure it. If you want to frame that in terms of counterfactual definiteness, we say either M would have clicked or M would not have clicked. Then by simple algebra, since Q can only take the values plus or minus 1, by simple algebra on any given run, we know that this has to be true. That's just a sort of trivial matter of algebra. And therefore, for any single ensemble, which we'll denote by the subscript ENS, the expectation values measured on that ensemble have to satisfy this inequality. Now, by the principle of induction and the principle of non-invasive measurability, those ensembles on which ideal negative result measurements are made at different pairs of times are identical in their statistical properties. If that's correct, then we can replace the ensemble averages by the averages on runs at which measurements are only made at these particular times. This is precisely what's measured in the experiment, and therefore that gives you the CHSH-like inequality as applied to the actual measured quantities. Okay. Proof is clearly rather parallel to what one would do in the original EPR bill context. Now, notice that the whole idea of macrorealism or macroscopic counterfactual definiteness really implies that the clicked and non-clicked states of your measuring device are sufficiently orthogonal or distinguishable that you can actually say with certainty that on any given run it has clicked or is not clicked. Okay? In other words, the measurements have to be projective in the sense of von Neumann. The state of the measuring device for Q equals plus 1 has to be quite different, orthogonal to the state for which Q is minus 1. Have any such measurements been carried out? Yes, there's a nice experiment by the Oxford group, Ni et al, which has, I think, now come out, I think, in Nature, which has used this scheme to test realism at the microscopic level, that is the level of single nuclear spins. They didn't actually do the ancillary test of classical non-invasiveness. I guess they sort of took for granted that in some sense that would work. Needless to say, when they did this test of quantum mechanics, or rather of realism at the microscopic level, they found it doesn't work. Quantum mechanics rules okay. The level of nuclear spins, no great surprise. What about macroscopic systems? This now gets a lot more messy. If you think about a typical macroscopic system, like say a superconducting qubit, von Neumann measurements are in principle possible, but in real life they're really extremely difficult, and the technology right now is such that they're really pretty much impossible to realize in the precise context that you want. Right now, that may well change in the next few years, but so far it seems to be so. So that led to a question which was raised by Ruskov, Korotkov, and Mizell a few years ago. They asked, is it possible to test macrorealism with so-called weak measurements? And they gave the answer yes to that question. And there was an experiment a couple of years ago by the Saclay group, Palacios Laloy et al, which claimed to test macrorealism with weak measurements. Now, there are actually two different issues, I think, which this experiment raises. One is simply, were the states in question which they were comparing macroscopically distinct? And I think really the answer is no, despite the fact that they were dealing with a macroscopic circuit, a so-called transmon circuit, a particular kind of Josephson device. Nevertheless, the states, if you look at it hard, the states in question are what I think most people would not regard as macroscopically distinct. But that's a sort of minor point in this issue. A much more important point is the idea of testing macrorealism with measurements viable or not. So let's just do a digression for the moment to just talk briefly about weak measurements. You had some of you were at Dr. Shukla's talk a couple of weeks ago when she talked about this. Let me just try to remind you of some of the principles. Von Neumann's original idea which has been enormously influential in the whole discussion of measurement in quantum mechanics, is that a typical measurement might work something like this. You start off, suppose you start off with your system in a particular microstate, and let's suppose for the moment that it's in the microstate, it's in an eigenstate of the quantity you want to measure. So if we're doing a Stern-Gerlach experiment and we've put our magnetic field gradient to couple to, say, the Z component of spin, we assume that our original atom does have a well-defined, it is in an eigenstate of the Z component of spin. Then we, our measuring device starts in some unspecified state, phi zero. We then turn on some kind of interaction between the system and the measuring device, as a result of which the measuring device makes a transition into a different state, which we'll again label with subscript I, which is its final state. And the crucial point now is that values of the final states of the measuring device corresponding to different original eigenstates of your microsystem must be orthogonal. In fact, there must be, to be a useful measuring device, there must be more than that. There must be, in fact, distinguishable more or less with the naked eye or something like that. But they certainly must be, yes. Sorry? Well, they must be, I mean, for the measuring device to function as what we would normally think a measuring device is, we ought to be able to read off the different possible states more or less with the naked eye. Or at least with the help of some kind of simple amplification device. But it's certainly essential that the final states of the measuring device be mutually orthogonal for different values of the system variable. Now, it turns out, von Neumann mentions this, that one way to achieve such a result is to switch on an interaction between the system and the measuring device, which is proportional. First of all, it's proportional to the variable which you're trying to measure. So, for example, in the case of a Stern-Gerlach measurement, it would be proportional to sigma z. It's also proportional, not to the coordinate, but to the momentum of the measuring apparatus. And then it's convenient to assume that it's a delta function in time for the purpose of the analysis. Of course, this is a gross oversimplification of a real measurement, but it does give the essence, hopefully. What's essential, however, is that basically this Hamiltonian applied for the delta function pulse shifts the coordinate of the measuring device. And what's essential is that you shift the coordinate of the measuring device by an amount, that is g, this amount here, this amount by which it's shifted, should be large compared to the zero-point spread of the initial wave function of the measuring device. Okay? In other words, the measuring device certainly has some kind of uncertainty, and for the moment, let's just assume it's a quantum mechanical, it's a purely quantum mechanical uncertainty, in its the spread of its coordinate variables. In order to make an efficient measurement, it's got to be the case that the interaction between the system and the device shifts that coordinate by a way which is large compared to that initial uncertainty. Otherwise, we can't read off with certainty what the value of the variable was. Okay? That was von Neumann's original hypothesis. Now, in a famous paper in 1988, Aharonov, Albert, and Weidman discussed the case, a situation in which this is, in some sense, no longer true. Now, there's a sort of historically complicating factor here. A large emphasis in the discussion of Aharonov et al. Was the effect of subsequent of post-selection of one's ensemble in the light of a subsequent measurement. That is, they were going to do this so-called weak measurement, we'll discuss in a moment exactly what that is, at an intermediate time, and then make a final measurement, and condition their predictions on the outcome of the final measurement. Now, from the point of view of the present discussion, that bit of the argument is really irrelevant. You get some very fascinating things out of it, and they produce some very counter-bizarre and counterintuitive results, but But the present discussion really has nothing much to do with the idea of post-selection. So that, I think, has been a sort of complicating factor in. So what Harano and company asked is, what happens if G is reduced? Now, incidentally, I should say that if you completely disregard the importance in the Harano argument of post-selection, then the idea of weak measurement is one which, in some sense, has been around for a long, long time. I mean, experimental physicists have been using weak measurement since time immemorial to get information on their ensembles and so forth. They never, previous to this paper, I don't think they thought of the idea of using post-selection to enhance these, but they were certainly using weak measurement in this case. So what do we mean by weak measurement? Well, I suppose that here's the von Neumann situation. You start off with your apparatus wave function with a certain spread here. You then shift it by amount large compared to the spread. In a weak measurement, by contrast, you've turned the interaction down to the point where the shift is actually small compared to the original width of the measurement. In other words, in this case, the final states of the measurement apparatus are essentially identical. They're very far from being orthogonal. They're almost identical. In fact, I think you can easily see that with this kind of setup, very little information can actually be acquired from a single measurement. A measurement on a single atom or whatever will essentially tell you almost nothing. You just can't read off anything from the behavior of the measuring apparatus. However, if you couple to M continuously, if your system is not an atom, but let us say a Josephson device or something, and you're coupling to it continuously, then you may be able to use Bayesian inference to extract information about the system itself. And this is what Ruskov et al. Proposed to do in their 2006 paper. And what they claim, and this is a claim which I can't at the moment confirm, is that the time correlations of the measuring device should reflect the ones of the system. They make that claim. Okay, how does this work? Let me just try to sketch the argument, although I say I don't believe it, or at least I'm not convinced by it. So I'm just presenting what they say. So the experiment, which I mentioned, of Palacios Leloy et al., is the interpretation of that experiment is simply based on the model of Ruskov et al. Without any further amplification, so we really have to go back to the original theoretical paper. Look at this. So imagine we have a two-state system S, it might be a superconducting qubit, which is coupled to weakly but continuously to a measuring device M. The response of the measuring device is supposed to be given, and I think this already introduces some not entirely clear concepts, by the following formula. The value of the measuring device relative to some original reference value is given by the ideal response to the variable q, so that's this term is simply proportional to q of t, plus some noise. The noise is supposed to have well-defined statistical properties, its average should be zero, and its correlations in the paper of Ruskov et al. Is given by white noise here. Now, I think immediately this you might perhaps ring a few warning bells at this stage, because if in fact the noise is not due to some kind of classical external agency, but is rather due to the zero-point uncertainty of the system itself, then it's not at all obvious that it's white. In fact, quantum noise typically is not white. So that already, I think, raises a problem. Okay, so now, in order for the Ruskov model to work, you have to invoke the weak coupling condition. And if you sort of stare at that and analyze it a bit, what this means, omega zero here is the oscillation rate of the qubit. And what this condition means is that the measuring device does not really efficiently detect the state of the system over a single period of measurement. That's the condition which they assume. Now, their claims go something like this. First of all, they try to work out, and this is pure quantum mechanics, they work out the damping rate of the two-state oscillations, and they claim that this damping rate is given by an uninteresting term, which is some kind of decoherence mechanism which is not associated with the measuring apparatus. It might just be due to sort of damping in the external circuits or something of the kind. But then the important term is this one here. And again, you see that if this term is much less than omega zero, this simply means that the effect of the measurement device in decohering the system is small over a period of oscillation. Now, the important claim in Ruskov et al. Is that both in quantum mechanics and in macro-realistic theory, but for quite different reasons, the output of the detector, that is the observed correlations of the detector, has correlations which are identical to the intrinsic correlations of the system itself. Okay? That's the important claim. They then note that we know that in macro-realistic theory, with our standard three assumptions, the CHSH-like inequality is satisfied for the correlations of the system itself. If this claim is correct, then it should also be satisfied for the observed output of the measuring device. Therefore, any experimental observation of the behavior of the measuring device which violates this inequality refutes the class of macro-realistic theories. And that was the principle which the Clay group used in doing their experiment. Okay, some comments on that. I think the most immediate comment is simply the following. The detector output itself is presumably continuously and efficiently monitored. If that's the case, then almost by definition, it satisfies a macro-realistic assumption. So it can't possibly by itself violate the CHSH-like inequality. What if you do get an apparent violation of that inequality, what does that indicate? Well, it simply indicates that since the output of the measuring device has not only a term, when scaled by the appropriate calibration, that output is not simply proportional to the variable of the system. It also has the noise term here. This term, admittedly, can only be plus or minus one, but this term can be almost arbitrarily large. So all you're really saying is that if you violate this, then that just shows that there's been a lot of noise on your measuring device. So this seems to me to put the significance of the raw data, which is observed in this experiment, in a rather different light. So the crucial element in the argument is indeed their claim that both for quantum mechanics and for macro-realism, the correlations of the measuring device faithfully reflect the correlations of the system. If that's true, then my previous remark may be, it's still true, but it's not, it doesn't kill the significance of the experiment. Here's their argument for this. They point out that by definition, the response of the measuring device is given by this correlation here. And now you look at the various terms in this expression. This term is, in some sense, the one you want to keep. This term vanishes by causality because, by definition, the noise is a random process. So the noise at time t plus tau cannot be affected by what the system was doing at time t. That's the hypothesis, anyway. This term vanishes for tau, any value of tau other than zero, by the white noise assumption. So you're left now with these two terms here. And the claim then is that in both quantum mechanics and macro-realism, this term goes away. And that's, I think, the delicate and difficult point. That's not quite correct. At this point, I get lost. I really get lost with the argument of Ruskov et al., and I've never been able to clarify this. They say that in quantum mechanics, these two terms are both non-zero, but the result of considering them both is that you get out the final prediction for the behavior of the measuring device, the correlation of the measuring device, which are identical to the correlations of the system. So I don't follow that argument. I have a student who's trying to go through it right now and re-derive it by a more rigorous result. So far, he hasn't come to any conclusions on that. However, I think in some sense, more important is the claim that in macro-realistic theory, this term should be zero and then should give you, again, the result that Km is equal to K. And the only argument which Ruskov et al. Give for this, this conclusion is that since it's possible to make measurements without, I'm quoting directly from their paper, since it's possible to make measurements without disturbing the system, there's no reason that any correlation has to arise between the noise that registered in the detector and the physical characteristic Q of T of the system being measured. I actually think this is a total misunderstanding of the whole idea of non-invasive measurability. We never said that when the system was actually interacting with the measuring device, there would be no effect. What we did claim was that if, in fact, the system was in a state which is not coupling to the measuring device, then there should be no effect. So it seems to me that this is just a totally different statement that they're invoking here. It has nothing to do with the idea of non-invasive measurability, as Anupam Gurga and I originally introduced it in 1985. Okay, so, well, basically, so as I say, one can't use, one may, it's conceivable, as Jonathan was suggesting, that one may be able to generalize the sort of argument I've used concerning non-invasive measurability to apply to a weak measurement context, but it's not been done and is not done in the existing experiments, certainly. So I think that the as far as I can see at least, the Ruskov et al. Proposal is just doesn't fly, or well, it doesn't fly, it may tell you something, it's not telling you what I'm interested in, what I think most people are interested in. Okay, well, basically that was what I wanted to cover on the question of a macrorealism and weak measurement. Okay, well, let me just sort of review briefly one or two other things that we did in the course. Now, we covered a number of different topics, I think about eight different topics in total. One of the topics, which I covered quite early on, was this question of supersolidity in solid helium-4. And here, to my own surprise, I have to tell you that I think the ground has shifted quite considerably since I gave that lecture. Or at least, well, my knowledge of the ground has shifted is probably a better phrase. When I gave the two lectures on supersolidity, I did point out that you have what you're basically measuring, and not all, but most of the experiments, the relevant experiments, and mostly torsional oscillator experiments. And in the torsional oscillator experiments, the crucial quantity which you're trying to measure is the frequency of your oscillator, right? And that is given by the square root of the some kind of force constant associated with the oscillator's suspension divided by the moment of inertia of your system. And the original Penn State experiments were interpreted, well, they saw a shift in the frequency, and they interpreted that as a change in the moment of inertia. They were careful. They did several ancillary tests to try to rule out the possibility that it was due to this this torsion constant. Now, a few years later, as I mentioned, there were experiments which showed that just about at the point in temperature and pressure and so forth where Penn State and others were seeing these remarkable effects, there was independently measured a change in the shear modulus of the of solid helium-4. That's reproducible. A number of groups have reproduced that result. And of course, this raised the suspicion that maybe what was going on in the torsional oscillator experiments had something to do with this. If the shear modulus of your part of your system changes, then in general it's going to affect the K. Yeah. Now, as I say, the Penn State people were and have been over the last 10 years extremely careful. They've done a number of ancillary tests to try to rule out the possibility that it was is K and not I, which is changing. The most important tests are, first of all, that if you block your annulus, then you don't appear to see these anomalous effects. So that, at first sight at least, says that it has to be, the effect has to be connected with the connectivity of the annulus. Second important test was that they replaced the helium-4 by helium-3. Again, although the helium-3 also shows the change in the shear constant, there were no supersolidity effects observed in the helium-3. And the final test was that the effect occurs in the supersolidity effect occurs in narrow narrow pores of helium in Vicor when, for various reasons, you would one would argue that changes in the torsional constant should not matter. I had an exchange of letters in the last 2 or 3 weeks with Moses Chan, who's the, of course, the person who really kicked this whole field off in 2004. And I have to tell you that he's very skeptical now about that he really was seeing what he thought originally thought he'd seen. And I asked him specifically about some of these controlled experiments. And apparently, according to what he's saying now, in each of those experiments, there is unfortunately a catch. In the case of the helium-3 experiment, they had a leak in their apparatus between the helium-4 and the helium-3. They had to replace it, and he thinks that may have changed things. Again, he has an explanation. I don't recall the details right now, but he believes he has an explanation of the blocked annulus experiment and so forth. If this is true, there's almost been a sort of vast conspiracy of nature in this area over the last 8 years or so, because really, I mean, they did everything humanly possible to try to exclude this explanation, yet it now looks as if maybe this is what's going on. So, I mean, there are one or two experiments which really are, which are ideally one should try to do to pin this down with certainty. But, well, if the person who originally, as it were, kicked off the whole field now thinks that the explanation is different, one has to take that quite seriously, I think. So, the state of affairs in that particular area does seem to have changed rather drastically. Okay, well, I guess we've sort of reached the end of our period. Thank you all for your loyal attendance.